black thing go from left to right, and I thought, I'm going to die out here. No one's ever going to know.
Five, five, four, four, three, three, two, one, one.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. The look it was giving me.
Seth, what would you report?
Jesus Christ, you bet. Sheriff, see ya.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show.
Happy holidays, everyone. Thanks so much for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you tonight. We're going to be doing the best of Volume 3, and it seems like a weird tradition around here, and I'll tell you another time how that got started. But basically, I pulled some of my favorite shows, my favorite eyewitnesses, and put them together into one big show. And I know a lot of people are traveling and looking for something to listen to, or you're spending time with family. Maybe you're tired of family, want to put the earbuds in. Either way, thank you so much for being here tonight. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. And if you get a chance, check out sasquatchchronicles.com. You can become a member and get additional shows. Let's jump into it tonight. You know, one of the shows I pulled was the Millrace Monster. And I know it doesn't sound like it, but I put a lot of hours into creating this. The Millrace Monster is in Indiana. People have been seeing it for years and years and years. Most of the descriptions are the same. Let's jump into it. Take a listen. I know it's real, and what I saw is not a joke. It was not a person in a costume. It was really something that could move around. It could grimace its face. It was growling. It was very aggressive. So people can think what they want to. I know what I saw, and it was pretty bad. I don't want to think about it too long, because it scares me to this day. On November 1st, 1974, the Columbus Police Department received a series of panicked reports from several eyewitnesses, all who have claimed to have seen and even been attacked by a huge bipedal green-skinned monster that stalked the waterways inside Indiana's 83-acre Millrace Park. These encounters would alarm locals and lead to what some considered to be the biggest monster hunt in the history of the United States. The first encounter involved four young women. At approximately 3 p.m. on November 1st, 1974, one of the young women spotted the thing between two trees near the paved boat ramp that led to the East Fork of the White River, not far from where the Driftwood and Flat Rock River merge. The terrified teens wasted no time in escaping the park and reported the incident to law enforcement officials. They stated that they had seen a green, hairy, large creature. But this wouldn't be the last time the creature was seen. Later on that same evening, a pair of women, having heard nothing about the teenager's earlier sighting, decided to stop in the Milrace Park to chat and eat the fast food they had picked up. Only one of the pair to ever come forward regarding this event was Tyra Catalan. She related details of the incident. It was just a typical evening, shortly after Halloween, and we decided to take our dinner down to the park and eat it and talk. We were just kind of staring out into the dark woods. Out from the woods comes this thing. They had to have been at least 7 feet tall, if not taller. It was way taller than a normal man. It was beating on the windshield, trying to get in, and we were screaming. Through the battered and mucus-smeared windshield, Catalan finally managed to get a look at the monster. There was a greenish tinge to him, the thing's face. I don't know if it had been in the river, drinking, and it got moss on it, because there was so much slime on its face. It did have fangs, and it was trying to bite through the glass. And I was afraid he was going to tear the door off. Nothing has ever scared me as much as that. Finally, the driver of the car was able to compose herself enough to start the engine, and the pair made a quick exit. Like the teenage girls who had seen the thing earlier in the day, the women who did not know the girls, who had not heard their story, drove straight to the police station to report the monster. The police, according to Catalan, were no more prone to believing these older eyewitnesses than they had been with the first group. It seemed like they were laughing about it. They said, "Oh, monster? Really? Have you been drinking?" I said, "No, it's real. It's out there. You gotta go down there. It's out there, and it's going to get somebody." The skeptical officers started to change their tune about a monster lurking, because there was no denying the damage done to the car or the horrific stench that surrounded it. This wouldn't be the last report to come in. Several reports had come in to the Columbus Police Department, even by city officials who had seen the creature. The creature was being seen so much, the local media had picked up the story. Soon there were small local posses being formed, people going out with guns. The frightened locals were armed to the teeth and roaming around in the dark near residential areas. The city park director had ordered the park to be closed. The locals call the creature the Milrace Monster, and it's still being seen today. Had a lot of fun putting that together. You know, one of the guests that actually stuck out to me this year was a helicopter pilot I had on the show, Todd. And he worked for a utility company that inspects high-tension power lines. And they do maintenance on the lines. He's the pilot, and then there's the maintenance guy or the engineer that flies with him. And they were flying in northern Utah, and as they came up over the tree line, they came into this big clearing, and that's when they saw the creatures. Very fascinating account. Let's take a listen.
Late June, early July of 2017, I'm a helicopter pilot. I've been flying for, 17 years now. And I work for a utility company, and we do a lot of power line surveying, power line inspections, and do a lot of power line construction. And this, we do jobs all over the country, so we're constantly on the road, and we stay out better part of 6 months out of the year, because anything, north of I-40 after, October starts getting really bad weather, snow and stuff like that, and we don't want to fly or work in that kind of stuff, so a lot of our stuff is done during the spring and summer months. But anyway, so we were doing a surveying job in northern Utah, and we were stationed, or we had two aircraft on this job that were in Naples, Utah. I don't know if you're familiar where that's at. and the where we were surveying was the Ashley, I think it's the Ashley National Forest, just north of that. And so generally we'd take off, and there's another guy in the aircraft with us. Me being the pilot, obviously I'm flying, but the guy that normally rides with me is a lineman. His job is to survey the power lines, because as a pilot, I don't know anything about power lines. I don't know what I'm looking at. I just know I stay away from them. But he typically rides on a platform outside the aircraft in case he needs to get off the aircraft and actually get onto these lines and do a repair or anything like that. But this particular job, we weren't doing repairs at this moment. We were just inspecting and surveying. So he was riding up front, and we had took off, I want to say about 7 o'clock that morning. It was a clear day. Sun was up. It was just a beautiful day. So we had made our way up, I want to say between maybe on the more eastern part of the national forest, and we had kind of made our way around this this rock facing. And I normally fly, you know, 50 to 100 feet off the trees, and it's not for excitement or anything like that. It's just easier for what he's needing to look at and what I'm needing to look at. And as I made kind of a left turn around this rock cliff or this mesa, whatever you want to call it, I saw a clearing to my right, but I didn't pay much attention to it. And after we kind of rounded around that clearing, the guy that flies with me, his name is Gary, he started telling me that, hey, you need to turn around, you need to turn around. And he's hitting me on the shoulder, and he's getting super excited, and I've never seen the guy like this. I mean, he's generally pretty quiet, pretty laid back, and if you see him smile, it's a rare occasion. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I need to turn around. He's like, you need to turn around. There was somebody standing in that clearing. And I'm like, what do you mean somebody? So I did a 180. I turned around. I came back to the clearing, and I came to a hover right off the edge of the clearing. I was about 50 feet or so off the top of the trees. The trees, that area up there is pretty dense, I guess cypress or pines or whatnot. But there was a pretty decent clearing, I guess about 50, 75 yards across, big enough I could have easily have landed in it. And I'm sitting there looking, I'm expecting to see, you know, elk or deer or something. And I don't see anything at first. And then he starts getting really high pitched, and he's like, look at that. And he's pointing. And as I'm looking, I really can't see anything. And then I realize what he's pointing at is obstructed by the flight console in the front of the cockpit that has all my gauges and my GPS, stuff like that. So I turn a little bit to the right with a pedal, and I look down to where he's pointing. And what I'm looking at, best way I can describe it to you, is it looked like an industrial-sized refrigerator with legs and a ghillie suit. That's how big it was. Now, the hair that was on it, the best I can remember, was, you know, it wasn't super long, but, you know, I could clearly see, you know, long arms. I couldn't get much detail out of his face because of the distance we were at, but I'd put this thing at least 10 feet. I'd never seen anything that big, and I've flown, like I said, I've been flying for 17 years. My flying career started in the Army. I've flown in Iraq, Afghanistan, South America. I've flown pretty much everywhere you can think of, and I've seen all kind of animals. I've never seen anything that big. And I say it was a male. I couldn't see anything like that, and I wasn't looking for anything like that, but it just kind of gave off this persona that it was a male, just by the way he was standing his ground and whatnot. But as I'm standing there looking at it, we're conversating, trying to figure out, you know, what is this? Because I had no idea what I was looking at. I'd heard of Bigfoot as a kid. As an adult, I'd heard of Bigfoot, but I'm not a researcher. I'm not one of those people that goes on and looks at YouTube videos or anything like that. You know, I got turned on to your podcast just a couple months ago by one of the other guys that I work with. And slowly but surely, I'm trying to play catch up, man. You've got a lot of episodes to play catch up with. But anyway, we're sitting here conversating about what we're looking at. And I kept trying to tell myself that it was a person, but then there was another part of me that kept saying, no, that's not a person. It doesn't look like a person. It's not holding itself as a person, and it's just too freaking big. And about that time, Gary, the guy's name that rides with me, he spots a second one about the time I think I probably spotted the second one same time he did, but it was, the second one was, I'd say about a foot and a half shorter and not as big as I'm going to call the big guy. And it kind of gave off the appearance or the presence that it was kind of a female because of how it was standing behind him to his right. And as far as the color of both of them, they were both kind of similar, you know, that dark auburn type looking hair. And she was just, when I say she, I don't know if it was a she, but it was, like I said, it kind of, you know how you get that kind of impression when you see an animal, whether it's a dog or a deer or whatever, you kind of automatically get that insight that maybe it's a male or a female. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Yeah, I know what you mean.
Okay. All right. And so that's why I keep saying that the smaller one, I think, was a female. But so again, we're sitting there. I'm still trying to wrap my head around what I'm looking at. And, you know, having been in the Army, being a helicopter pilot as long as I've been, I just could not wrap myself around what I was looking at, if that makes sense. I was more, I don't know if it was shock, if it was disbelief. I'm not sure what it was. I just know that it wasn't what I expected to see when I turned around, you know what I mean? He got excited. He's an avid hunter. I hunt occasionally, not as much as he does. So, like I said, I half expected to turn around there be a herd of elk or something like that, and I thought that's what he was getting excited about. But again, going back to these two, the larger of the two, he never broke his stance. It's like he maintained focus and eye contact on the helicopter, and it didn't. The rotor wash, the noise, what I had seen other animals in the past that we had come up on, you know, they just scatter. He stood his ground, and I don't know if it was out of curiosity or what it was, but I mean, this thing, he just stood there and just never took his eyes off of us. And the smaller one I watched move around behind him, probably 5 or 10 feet off to his left. And she kind of bent down, and I thought maybe she was picking something up, or was, you know, the first thing I thought was, you know, is she picking up a rock or something to throw, or is she, you know, something like that. But when she bent down, a much, much, much smaller one, almost like, if you know what those little monkeys that people like to get as pets, what are they called, a capuchin or something like that?
Oh, yeah. Tiny monkey, they pick them up. Yeah.
Yeah, and it was, the movement of it was kind of resembled that. It kind of climbed up her arm and kind of perched itself on her back. Now, I've seen, you know, Discovery Channel, Animal Planet, and I've seen other primates do that same thing with their young. They're either latched on the front or latched on the back. But the seeing that, and I'm not saying it was even a baby. It was just something I watched climb up her arm and perch itself on her back. But then I noticed that there was two others that were much, much smaller than her that were kind of huddled together beside a tree. And going back to me saying that I think she was a female, was what she did next was she put herself between me and the two little ones on the ground, and they kind of took a few steps and they were gone. They disappeared. And the eye shot that I had and the view I had, I should have been able to see her walk back into this tree line for several feet, but it was like she took 3 or 4 steps and they were gone. Now, the bigger one, again, he has still not taken his eyes off of us. He took, I think, 2 or 3 steps backwards and turned to his left. But when he turned, his head never moved off of us. And then he took another step. His head moved, took his eyes off of us. I watched him take another step, and that was it. He was gone. And that was it.
What did you think you were looking at the time?
Honestly, at that particular moment, I had no idea what I was looking at. Gary and I even discussed it later that night when we had dinner, and he was in the same, kind of the same boat I was in. I had no idea what I was looking at. He had no idea what he was looking at. The term Sasquatch or Bigfoot honestly did not come up that night, but a couple days later it did. And we were up flying again, and I jokingly said, I hope we don't run into Bigfoot again. and he kind of did a little chuckle, and he goes, is that what you think we saw? And that's when the Bigfoot thing came out, and I was like, you know, what else could it have been? There's no way that was a person. There's no way that was, you know, some family of four or five living up here, and they've just adapted to the woods, and, you know, there's no way that was a human. So I don't really know what it was. Even to this day, you know, several years or a couple of years later, looking back on it, I think I know what it is. I think it's 100% a Bigfoot or Sasquatch, whatever you want to call it. At the time, like I said, I didn't know much about it. I'd heard a Bigfoot like everybody has. But now looking back, and after I've, you know, listened to your podcast, and I've listened to, there's a couple other podcasts that I listened to that kind of throw some Bigfoot stories in there. Matter of fact, you probably know both of those podcasts, but I think it was a Bigfoot or Sasquatch, whatever you want to call it. I think it was a family, maybe, and I don't know if maybe they had just, you know, that was their morning routine, and I just happened to stumble across it, because being that far up where we were at, it would take a person hiking a couple days to get to that location. So I don't, like I told you earlier today, I don't think anybody had, maybe a modern human being, I don't think a modern human being had been in that area. Now, maybe 200-300 years ago, maybe there was Native Americans there, but I don't think a modern human being has ever been in that area. So, you know, I think it was a Bigfoot. I can't explain it. I can't come up with anything else that it might have been.
Yeah, I know when we talked, you said you were like 60 miles in to this area, in the middle of nowhere. Now, when you're looking down at this thing, or down at these things, would you describe it more human-like? Would you say it was more of like a non-human primate? How would you describe it to someone who's never seen one?
Well, the big one I did notice, like I said, he was huge. I mean, if I measured his shoulders from tip to tip, I'd probably put him at 4 feet easily. I mean, it was huge, but I did notice that it appeared from my angle and the distance that I was, it appeared that his arms were much longer than they should have been. You know, as a human, our arms don't touch our knees when we're standing up straight. His, I'm pretty sure, reached either to his knees or just below his knees. Now, I couldn't see feet, not at that distance. I couldn't see a whole lot of detail either, but when she moved and how she walked, she kind of had kind of a hunched over upright stance, if that makes sense. And her movement was very deliberate. It was very sure footed, but I laugh at it now, but I've tried to imitate what I saw, how I saw her move. And I can't get my back bent and straight and my knees bent the way she did. And I don't know how else to describe it. And I don't know, I've never seen anything walk like that. But like I said, it was kind of a hunched over upright movement. And her legs, like, you know, us humans, when we walk, our legs, when we take a step, they straighten. When she took a step, hers didn't. Hers stayed bent at the knees.
What do you think that they are, Todd? What's your opinion?
Oh, man. I don't know, to be honest with you. I don't think, you know, like I said, I've been listening to your podcast for a couple months, and I'm trying to catch up, and I've listened to other people's stories, and I've heard other people say that, you know, they think they're paranormal because of how they can disappear, or how they, it just seems they disappear, and other people think they're primates. Other people think they're like a missing link in between humans and primates. And honestly, I don't know. I don't know if it's something, you know, from kind of the caveman days that we just haven't discovered that managed to survive. I don't know. Like I said, you know, I've flown all over the world. There are places that I know we've never been. There's got to be species of animals that we've never discovered. So to the people that I've heard say, oh, there's no way that there's a giant humanoid or an ape living in North America, Canada, whatnot, or anywhere else for that matter in the world. I mean, it's kind of idiotic to say, to be that closed-minded, because I saw it. I know what I saw. And having flown all over the world, I know that there are places that no human have ever stepped foot in. So I don't know. I don't know if it's kind of like a lost missing link between a human and a primate, you know, or if it is an ape, if it is a giant ape that we just don't know about, that we've never discovered yet.
Yeah, and what do you think that they were doing? You think they were just kind of coming out in the opening, and as you pass by, you kind of just caught them in the open?
I kind of got the feeling that early morning like that, a lot of animals forage first thing in the morning, you know, rabbits, squirrels, chipmunks, stuff like that, even deer. Honestly, I think that maybe they were coming out starting to forage. And I don't know what a Bigfoot eats, but, you know, again, I go back to your podcast. I've heard a couple episodes where people claim that they eat roots and vegetables and berries, and kind of the same diet. I think I heard somebody reference a bear, kind of the same diet as a bear. They do eat meat, but they also rely on a lot of berries and a lot of roots. And I kind of get the idea that maybe they were, you know, just kind of starting their day and was just kind of foraging when along. And then here I come just out of the nowhere and just kind of screwed up their whole morning. But that's kind of the feeling I got, was maybe they were kind of foraging for food maybe that morning.
Very cool account, and I want to thank Todd again for coming on the show. It's very hard to get a pilot to come on the show. I've talked to many of them off the air, but they don't like to come on publicly and talk about it. So I want to thank again Todd for coming on, one of my favorite guests I've probably talked to this year. I want to have a little bit of fun tonight. You know, I was just putting together this best of. One of the shows that came to mind, the first one that came to mind, was a William Rowe encounter in 1955. And I really wanted to do this show, but I wanted it to be entertaining. I wanted it to be something you guys would sit and listen to. And a little bit more than just me sitting and reading the account, because I would get bored doing that. And if I'm getting bored, I assume you guys are getting bored. So I wanted to kind of create a story within a story. And when I did this show, I got a lot of hate mail from people. People thought we were in a bar and I was being mean to Tony. And so I released the bloopers of us actually constructing this show. And so I'll play the bloopers for you first, and then I'll go right into the William Rowe account.
I must admit, I didn't think much of Merkel first time I laid eyes on him.
Oh, man. The audience is going to be like, what the hell is going on? All right. Let me try again. I'm keeping the chip sound effect, you know, the Sasquatch eating Doritos. It makes me laugh. It's non-negotiable. So we walk into the bar. The noise of the chair will move. Here, I'll start off. What's it called? Let me start again.
I'm just talking too much. I'm sorry. We can.
No, it's all right. You want to start again?
Just the bar scene. I think I kept on over talking on you. I mean, it doesn't really matter. You can edit it out, but it might help with the flow if I actually do it right. Yo, why are you telling me this in the third person?
First person.
That's what I meant.
Because it works better if I tell the story in first person.
Yo, why are you telling me this in the first person?
Because the story works better if I tell it in first person.
Okay.
Dick. Do you want to go and pay for our drinks when we get out of here?
What was I supposed to say?
That Tony Merkel never pays for drinks. Look at him.
You can't say that. Don't say that.
All right. All right. I got it this time. I got it. Just mute. Looks like a stiff breeze could blow him over. Oh, man. A stiff freaking breeze. And this is hilarious.
想看那些泪
I must admit, I didn't think much of Merkel first time I laid eyes on him. Looks like a stiff breeze could blow him over. That was my impression of the man. I could see why some took the man as annoying. He had a walk and a talk that just wasn't normal around here. And boy, could he drink. He drank like a man that didn't have a care or worry in the world. I hope to be done with this talk show one day. I hope fans stop asking me to do stupid voiceovers like this. I hope.
Yo, man, what's up?
Not a whole lot. Just in deep thought.
Ah.
Thinking good thoughts. Right,
well, you want to go get some drinks?
Yeah, let's get some drinks, man.
All right, cool.
Can we get two whiskeys on the rocks? Have a seat, brother.
Yeah, it's been one of those weeks, man. You ever heard the William Rowe encounter?
No, I don't think I have.
Well, let me tell you the story. The story begins in 1955. Ever since I was a small boy back in the forests of Michigan, I have studied the lives and habitats of wild animals. Later, I supported my family in northern Alberta by hunting and trapping. I've spent many hours just observing the wild things. They fascinated me. But the most incredible experience I ever had with a wild creature occurred near a little town in British Columbia, about 80 miles west of Jasper, Alberta. I had been working on the highway for about 2 years. In October...
Yo, why are you telling me this in the first person?
Because the story works better if I tell it in first person.
Okay.
I had been working on the highway for about 2 years. In October 1955, I decided to climb 5 miles up Mica Mountain to an old deserted mine, just for something to do. I came inside of the mine about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I had just come out of a patch of low brush into a clearing when I saw what I thought was a grizzly bear. It was in the bush on the other side. I had shot a grizzly near that spot the year before. This one was only about 75 yards away, but I didn't want to shoot it, for I had no way of getting it out. So I sat down on a small rock and watched, my rifle in my hands, of course. I could see part of the animal's head and the top of one shoulder. A minute later, it raised up and stepped out into the opening. Then I saw it was not a bear. My first impression was of a huge man, about 6 feet tall, almost 3 feet wide, and probably weighing somewhere near 300 pounds. It was covered from head to foot with a dark brown silver-tipped hair. But as it came closer, I saw that it had breasts and it was a female. And yet its torso was not curved like a female's. Its broad frame was straight from shoulder to hip. Its arms much thicker than a man's arms and longer, reaching almost to its knees. Its feet were broader than a man's, about 5 inches wide from the front and then tapering back to a thinner heel. When it walked, it placed the heel of its foot down first. I could see a gray-brown skin or hide on the soles of its feet. It came to the edge of the bush I was hiding in, within 20 feet of me, and squatted down on its haunches. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. It was reaching out with its hands. It pulled the branches towards its mouth and stripped the leaves with its teeth. Its lips curled flexibly around the leaves as it ate. I was close enough to see its teeth. They were white and even. The head was higher at the back than at the front. The nose was broad and flat. The lips and chin protruded farther than its nose. It had so much hair that covered its face, leaving bare only parts of the face around the mouth, nose, and ears. It resembled an animal as much as a human. None of the hair, even on the back of its head, was longer than an inch.
and the hair on the face was much shorter. Its ears were shaped like human ears. Its eyes were small and black, like a bear's. And the neck was also unhuman, thicker and shorter than any man's I've ever seen. As I watched the creature, I wondered if some movie company was making a film, but as I observed it more, I decided it would be impossible to fake such a specimen. Things got real, real quick. Finally, the wild thing must have gotten my scent. It looked directly at me through an opening in the brush. Ah, a sigh of relief. The creature had a look of amazement that crossed its face. It looked so comical at the moment, I had to grin. Still in a crouched position, it backed up three or four short steps, then straightened up to its full height, and started to walk rapidly back the way it had come. For a moment, it watched me over its shoulder as it went. Not exactly afraid, but as though it wanted no contact with anything strange. The thought came to me that if I shot it, I could possibly have a specimen of great interest to scientists the world over. I've heard stories of Sasquatch from the legends of the British Columbian Indians. Also, others have made many claims. Maybe this was a Sasquatch, I told myself. I leveled my rifle. The creature was still walking rapidly away, again turning its head to look in my direction. I lowered my rifle. Although I had called the creature an it, I felt now that it was a human being, and I knew I would never forgive myself if I killed it. Just as it came out to the other patch of brush, it threw its head back and made a peculiar noise that seemed to be a half laugh and half language. Then I walked from the small brush into a stand of long pole pines. I stepped out in the opening and looked across a small ridge just beyond the pine to see if I could see it again. It came out on the ridge a couple hundred yards away from me, tipped its head back again, and again emitted some strange, odd sound. It sounded like half laugh, half language. I don't know. It disappeared then and I never saw it again. I wanted to find out if it lived on vegetation entirely or ate meat as well. So I went down and looked for signs. I found it in five different places, and although I examined it thoroughly, I could find no hair or shells or bugs or insects. So I believe it's strictly vegetarian. I found one place where it slept for a couple nights under a tree. Now the nights were cool up on the mountain at this time of year, and yet it had not used a fire. I found no sign that it possessed even the simplest of tools, nor a single companion while in this place. Whether this was a Sasquatch, I don't know. It will always remain a mystery to me unless another one is found. I hereby declare the above statement to be in every part true, to the best of my powers of observation and recollection. Signed, William Rowe. And that's the story of William Rowe, 1955 encounter, one of the classics. So you gonna pay for our drinks or what?
Yeah, I'll go pay for the drinks.
Yeah, that sounds good. That sounds real good. Tony Merkel, guy never pays for a drink, ever.
Hey, I pay for the drinks again. I paid for the last 10.
That's actually probably accurate. Let's get out of here, man.
All right, man, let's go. Hey, what are you doing?
I'm going to class this place up before we leave.
All right.
Let's get out of here.
Let's go.
Don't
thanks for coming along and making this a great occasion. You know, one of the accounts that really stood out to me was Mike from Mississippi, and he witnessed an older woman feeding these creatures live animals, and the account always stuck with me. Take a listen.
You talked briefly, and I gave you a little background, but I want to kind of go back to the beginning of the day, because after listening to some of your shows on YouTube, I'm a fairly new listener, and for me, hindsight is 2020, and there's been a lot playing in my mind over the last month or so. So I was 7 years old. I'm 36 years old now. So this was well over 20 years ago. I'm the oldest of six kids. I'm a mama's boy. If you look in the dictionary and look up mama's boy, you'll have my picture right there beside it.
Yeah.
So I'm the oldest of six kids, and had a lot of responsibility on me. I was forced to be the man of the house at an early age. I never saw my mom and my dad together. My dad was in and out of prison for a lot of my life, so my mom raised me. I still love my dad, still talk to him every day, but my mom raised me. To get away from the stress during the weekend, I would ask my grandmother and my grandfather if I could spend the weekend to get away from the stress during the week, because I babysat a lot. My mom worked multiple jobs. I would sometimes ask my grandmother and my grandfather if I could spend the night at their place. And a lot of the grandkids always felt that I was their favorite, because they would ask to spend the night, and my grandmother and my grandfather wouldn't let them stay, but they would let me stay. So this particular Saturday morning, we were down at my grandmother's house, and I asked to spend the night, and they agreed, and everybody ended up leaving around maybe 1 or 2 p.m. in the evening. I can't really remember the exact times, but I know it was daylight. And we left to go to the grocery store to pick up a few things, and we went to Walmart to pick up a few things, and I remember being in the back seat and my grandmother and my grandfather having a conversation, and they were talking, and they said, you know, I wonder if the shadows are going to show up tonight, if the ghosts are going to show up tonight. So I didn't think much of it, you know, just sitting in the back seat. So we get out, we make grocery. We, as you can see, I said make grocery. That's Southern people talk. Most people say buy grocery. Cedric, how are you going to make grocery? But that's the Mississippi in me. We go to the store, we make grocery, and we go back home. I want to say the neighborhood, Wes, if we could talk a few minutes afterwards, I'll tell you exactly what the neighborhood is, and I'll give you a little history on it. But if I was to tell you where this neighborhood is at, people from my hometown would know exactly where I'm talking about. A lot of weird and crazy and strange things go on there. So anyway, fast forward, we get back to the house. It's maybe, around 3 o'clock, we'll say. So, I'm playing outside, running around. You know, my grandmother, she's in there cooking and different things like that for my grandfather. He was a man of men. He was a really, really manly man. He rough and rugged, big, you know, big guy. 350 pounds, you know, solid, just, you know, big black guy, you know, no nonsense type of guy. But he was really good with us as kids, but we knew how far to go. So my grandmother was a strong, you know, black woman, the homemaker, you know, a nourisher, and her food would make your mouth water while you're eating her food. She makes the best seafood gumbo you ever taste in your life. So she's cooking and getting dinner and stuff ready, and I'm the only grandchild there. So by that time they call me in. Let's just say I want to be 100% truthful with you. I don't know the times, but let's just say it's around 5 o'clock now. So in Mississippi at this time, the sun is about to set, right? So they called me in and they said, you know, hey, come on in. It's time to, you know, take your shower and we're going to get ready to sit down and eat. So I go in and I bathe. We didn't have a shower. We didn't have a shower. I bathe and got myself together. And so by the time we sit down, the sun is really starting to set to where the sky is starting to change, where it's going to get ready to get dark. So my grandmother and my grandfather, they go out and they sit on the porch. And the only reason why I don't want this story being told is because they're still living, and I know it'll be a lot of controversy. But anyway, so they go out and they sit on the porch. I'm sitting there and I'm watching television. Me and my grandmother used to like Showtime at the Apollo. We would watch that together. But it didn't, at the time, I think that didn't come on until like 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock at night. So we still had a few hours. So I'm going to fast forward a little bit. Let's just say maybe it's around 6:30 or 7 now. So it's gotten dark. But if you were driving on a road with your lights off, you could still see. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but it's kind of that twilight.
Yeah, so it's dark now. I'm sitting there watching television, and they're sitting out on the porch. And so let me try to explain this to you. So the way this house is set up, and I'm going to be going home soon, and I'm going to send you a picture. And this is what really gives me relief to hear some of the stories, because for a long time, I felt that what happened really didn't happen because I just kind of put it out of my mind. But I I'll tell you why I know what happened really happened, because I got confirmation from my mom, who passed away 6 years ago from a brain aneurysm, a blood vessel burst in her brain and it killed her. She never woke up from it. So it's starting to get dark. My grandmother, my grandfather sitting on the porch. So the way this porch set up was, this porch had to be about, let's say, maybe 7 feet wide, but it was a screened-in porch, a box house. It was a house shaped like a big box. In Mississippi, they call what you have shotgun houses. If you walk in the front door, you can immediately see the back door, right? So if you walk through the front door, it's like a hallway. You may walk maybe 10 feet and it'll open up into the kitchen, but the bathroom and the bedrooms, they're off to each side of the hallway. So if I walk through the front door, I can immediately see the back door straight through the hallway. That's in Mississippi. You probably heard of that before, but that's called a shotgun house. So this house is shaped like a big box, but this house sits up on four big brick beams. So you have one big brain, beam at the corner, and I would say those beams are about maybe 4 feet high, but this house sits up off the ground. As kids, we could go up under that house and kind of play around. You could stand up under it. It was dusty and dirty under there, but we would go up under that house and play and different things like that. So there's four big concrete beams that this house sits up off of. And to get up to the front door of the porch, you may have to walk up maybe 6 to 8 concrete steps to open up the front the screen door to the porch. You get onto the porch and then you walk maybe another 2 feet and then you open up the front door. So my grandmother and my grandfather, they're sitting out here on the front porch. So as you described, you say it's around the twilight time where it's dark, but you can still see. I walk out to the porch and I'm listening to them talk. And my grandmother and my grandfather, they're staring across the street. So by the way that this house, it sits up on a hill, but it sits up on this beam. So down, and I'm not good with my distance, I would say, man, maybe about 70 yards. I would say this house is about 70 yards away. Down, if I'm sitting on the porch and my grandmother and my grandfather are sitting to the front of the porch and they're in their chairs, they can look down on this double wide trailer. Now, this older woman who was Native American and African American, she had built a porch and different things like that so the porch was something that was created by someone afterwards once she purchased that house. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense.
So she kind of added on to the house. She built like, you know, a porch and a back little deck area. The porch area was closed in. It had a tin top on it, but it was, you know, really nice, like a light brown wood type porch on it where she could come out and sit outside. So if we're looking down, we can see her entire yard except for her backyard. There was a street that separated my grandparents' house from her house, but we could see her house as clear as day. So I walk outside, and my Madea and my dad, I call my grandma Madea, and I call my granddad Dad. My Madea and my dad, they're both sitting out there on the porch, and my grandmother asks Dad, "Oh, look, do you see it?" And I'm attempting to say their names, and my granddad said, "Yeah, I see it." So I'm looking, you know, I look, you know, all around and I don't see what they see. And my granddad said, "It's at the window." So I'm looking around and I'm trying to figure out exactly what they're seeing. I'm still not figuring out exactly what they've keyed in on. And I hear a loud bump, but what it was, it was a slap on the trailer is what I really think it was. I think this thing slapped the trailer. And when this thing slapped the trailer, the living room light went off and the kitchen light came on. And now I'm looking at this thing and it's huge, man. This thing is huge, and it has the same color fur as a silverback gorilla without the silver. And it looks like a freaking baboon with maybe three pair of shoulder pads on going across. And towards the hips, it makes like a V, and the legs protrude out a little bit more. The hips are not as wide as the shoulders, but the hips are about halfway wide as the shoulders. And I'm looking at this freaking huge baboon face, hairy covered creature standing at the kitchen window. So the living room light goes out, the kitchen light comes on, and this woman comes to the kitchen window, and this thing has to like almost peep down into the kitchen window. This is just how tall this thing is. This woman I'm looking at this little lady. She looks at this thing. I can see her face. She looks at this thing. This thing looks back at her, and I can see his cheeks come in and out, and it blows. Oof. Oof. She looks at it. It gives two. Oof. Oof. She leaves away from the window. She walks back towards the living room. She opens up her front door. Have you ever been coon hunting before?
I haven't, no. I know it's big down there in Mississippi though.
Yes, sir. We will substitute a coon for a turkey on Thanksgiving any day. This woman brings out first she sets out a coon. It's a coon trap, and it has a cat in it. She sets that out on the porch. She goes back and she gets another trap, and it's a raccoon in the trap. She sets that out on the porch. Now, here is where the thing I can only describe as a giant spider comes from around the porch. My grandmother or my granddad says, "Ooh, look, there's another one." So when the head pops on, the woman has floodlights on the side of her trailer. When the floodlights come on, it draws my attention to the reason why the floodlights popped on in the first place. I see a huge head, just a head, kind of peeping from around the corner of this trailer. And then I see what would be the right arm comes from around, and some of the body kind of snakes around the trailer. And then I can see the left arm come around, and the body of this thing comes around, and I see something that's dangling, and I'm thinking, okay, these are arms, but the arms look too small to be arms. So when the rest of the body comes around, it's crawling, but it's up off the ground, but it's on like a belly crawl, but it's on all fours almost. So that's when I see the other two legs. So I'm thinking that, I'm like, what the hell is this? So now, as I explained to you earlier, I realized I saw two arms, two breasts, and then the rest of the legs. This thing crawls to the front porch and stands up. This thing is about maybe a foot and a half smaller than what's standing at the window. But now this thing is now looking over at the thing that's on all fours, walk towards the porch. This thing stands up, and the raccoon and the freaking cat is going bananas in the cage. It's going freaking bananas in the cage. This thing picks it up, walks back around to the back of the trailer where it came from. The big thing that was standing at the window gives another woof and walks off, and they leave.
Talk about scarring a kid, scarring anyone really for life. What did your grandparents say?
This is what bothers me, and this is why I wish to remain anonymous. Like, I get emotional, man, because I speak from my heart. You know, people say I wear my heart on my sleeve. That's just me. You know, that's the way God wired me. I can't change it about myself. I'm actually getting a little teary-eyed talking about it. I wish for the life of me that I could remember that date that happened. Because being in the backseat of that car, they knew whatever showed up that night was going to show up. No one can tell me that they didn't know whatever was going to show up that night was going to show up, because they talked about it on the way home, that they wondered if the shadow was going to show up or the ghost was going to show up. They sat there and watched it like it was normal, man. They sat there and watched it like it was normal. That's the only way I can explain that to you. Yeah, they sat there and watched it like it was normal, and they whispered and talked to one another to make sure that each other was seeing everything.
Makes you wonder if they had seen it before, if they had actually seen it on their property. Obviously, I mean, it's not that far away.
I'm happy you asked that question. So this is where I'm really going to get emotional, right? My mom, who I would give my life for, I would give my right arm. The Lord has blessed me to do pretty good in my life, you know, despite the circumstances that I've endured growing up as a young man in Mississippi. Me and my brothers and sisters, I'm the oldest of six kids. Sometimes we went hungry until the next day. You know, the only time we ate at school was at school sometime. My grandmother and my grandfather would go into that deep freezer, into that refrigerator, and bring food to I lived in the projects. I lived in a really, really rough part of the section of Mississippi where I was raised. I lived in a neighborhood so bad to where the police wouldn't show up until the gunshot stopped. Like, it was really, really bad, man. So as I told you before, staying with my Madea and my papa and my daddy, they gave me a chance to kind of get away because I could run and play where they lived. I had an uncle that lived right down the road from them where he had goats, a mule, chickens, hogs, and he would, you know, pay me, you know, $2 a day to go and help him, you know, feed slops to the hogs and different things like that. You know, I come from a place where most of the people, they grew everything, you know, that they ate. But my mom, being a single mom of several kids at the time, you know, she struggled a lot. And I, in between school and babysitting, things got really, really stressful on me because I was the man of the house at an early age. I left home at the age of 14 because my mom ended up getting involved with a guy that used to beat on her. And when I got of age, me and my brother, we weren't going for that anymore. But anyway, so the next day my mom comes to pick me up. And the ride home, I tell my mom what I saw. I tell her the entire story, just like I'm telling you. And my mom told me, oh, those have been around ever since I was a little girl. My mom told me those have been around ever since she was a little girl. She believed me because she saw it too. I don't know if it was in that same manner, but my mom has seen it too. My mom said those have been around ever since she was a little girl. She believed me.
Yeah, it's kind of nice getting the confirmation, you know, from your mother. Yeah.
My mom told me those have been around ever since she was a little girl, and she believed me. She asked me if my Madea and my daddy know I saw it, and they saw me looking at it too. And my mom told me not to repeat what I saw. But my brother, who is my best friend, I told him too. I told him what I saw too. He was a little skeptical at the time, but he knew that I wasn't lying. And I told him that mama said she saw the same thing growing up as a little girl. And my mom said everybody around that part of the neighborhood knew about those things.
I want to come back and ask you about if your mom ever shared an encounter. Before we get into that, you mentioned one of the creatures had a baboon look. Did it have kind of a snout, or did it have like that dog's, you know, where their face protrudes? Is that why you say baboon?
It looked like, this thing looked like a freaking giant but skinny, it had like a giant but skinny gorilla body. It wasn't as wide as a gorilla, but the just imagine if you take a giant baboon's head and sitting on top of a gigantic gorilla body.
I got you.
The snout and the face protruded, so the snout had the wrinkles in it. The face was a dark, almost leathery black. The face was like an almost dark, leathery black. The eyes, I couldn't really see the color on the one that was facing the kitchen window. All I could see was black from the side. Now, when it faced to look towards us, I mean, when it faced to look towards the one that was crawling on the ground, all I could see was black. But this thing clearly had like a gorilla. It had a gorilla face, but the snout was more protruded, if that makes sense. And the female looked almost identical, just a little bit smaller.
Yeah, the whole thing is fascinating to me, especially the woman's behavior too. Almost like it was dinner time, and she—I hate to hear the story about The cat.
That woman came to that window and looked at that thing without any fear. She was not afraid. And this is not a big woman I'm talking about. This is a small woman. This was not a big woman. This was a small Native American and African American woman. She was not a big woman at all.
What a terrible thing to see. I mean, most adults would freak out when they see that. And that's why, you know, I know you clarified it, but that's what made me curious about your grandparents, because it was like, time to watch a show.
I wonder if they seen it before.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking when they're sitting there watching it, you know. And her behavior of feeding them is so bizarre. You know, one thing I really appreciate from your encounter, and it's somewhat selfish and it's vindication for me. I was telling you, Mike, when I first came out with my encounter, I talked about how when we saw it dropped all fours, it moved like a spider. I mean, it's the most bizarre thing you'll ever see. They don't move around like King Kong or like an ape. And I got so much crap for it from all these Bigfoot researchers and experts telling me, well, they don't move like that on all fours. And I'm like, well, I don't know what to tell you, man. I'm just telling you what I saw.
I have the hair standing on top of my head right now. Those things can snake around like a freaking snake. The arm wrapped around that house, I saw like at least 2 feet of arm after I saw the head. And the body snaked around. And then that's when the right arm, I think, the other arm came around. And not even half of the body, the first portion of the body I saw, and I saw something else dangling. And I thought it was the arms. And I'm like, how in the hell do I see arms already? The head and the back that I'm seeing so far in this thing doesn't account for arms showing. It was breasts. Now that I look back on it, hindsight is 20/20. And back then as a kid, I paid attention to a lot of stuff. Those were breasts on that thing. And it snaked around. The belly wasn't touching the ground, but it was a few inches above the ground. I'm not gonna say a few inches, maybe 10 inches above the ground. But this thing was crawling. And it moved, man. This thing looked like a freaking giant black snake. I'm telling you, I know what I saw. I know what I saw. And I love my mom, and I know what my mom told me. And I know what I saw for myself.
Poor Mike, what a thing to see. What a thing for a kid to see, let alone an adult to see. A very fascinating account. Mike had a ton of details in his encounter. You know, one of the witnesses I like to talk to the most beyond law enforcement is hunters. Because hunters know their surroundings. They're very good eyewitnesses when they've seen something that makes no sense. And I spoke to Dee from Illinois. He was actually out hunting. He had two encounters he shared with us. Let's check it out.
It was spring. I believe it was 2008. I was turkey hunting. And the night before I went out to roost the turkeys. And as night fell, I knew the turkeys had roosted in the tree and everything. So the next morning I had a spot to go back to. So next morning come along, I set my decoys out, and I set up maybe 100, 200 yards away from where the turkeys were roosted. And as the day progressed, you know, the darkness was turning morning, you know, light. And there was no turkeys. It was kind of weird. I've had it happen before, and I've always wrote it off as bobcats, you know, climbing a tree, spooking them out at night. And so I was sitting there kind of disgusted, and I heard some brush breaking. And it sounded, you know, something big was coming through the forest. So I kind of eased my head over, and I turned. I could see the brush moving, so I kind of like a hunter will do, instead of just standing up, you know, like, you know, looking at a place, I was kind of crouched over and I was looking, and there was this big figure. I mean, this, I'm guessing probably 400 to 500 pounds, 8 foot tall, hairy, had kind of reddish highlights to the hair. I don't know if that was the sun, but it walked. It never looked at me. It never did anything. It just walked straight down and went down over a draw, and I watched it as long as I could. It went down to a creek, and it crossed the creek and went up on the other side, and it went down this big draw. And it never looked at me. It never did anything, but it was really, really weird. And in this place I hunt, you can go in there almost any time of the year, and it's kind of a weird feeling. You feel like something's there, something's watching you. You look around, you hear noises, but you don't see nothing. This was the first time I'd ever seen that. And it kind of creeps you out a little bit, but it's not going to keep me out of the woods. I feel like if it was going to do something, it would have did it that day. I'm sure it knew I was there. And obviously, I don't know if they can detect the threat, because I have no intentions to ever, you know, hurt one, because I don't think you could, for one. And if you did, you better be locked and loaded with some bigger stuff than I had.
Yeah, I hear you. You know, I'm curious, can you describe what, for more, was there anything that stood out to you, and how far away from this thing was it?
I was probably 100 yards from it, and it was just, it was huge. I mean, it had shoulders on it. I'd be afraid to say how wide. I mean, probably 3 foot, 4 foot. And I couldn't see the hands, because, you know, the underbrush was starting to grow up in the spring, but it stood well above that. It kind of hunched over towards the, you know, it kind of walked with a hunch, leaning forward, no visible neck. It just looked like it went from, I don't know, kind of like the jaws right down to the shoulders, kind of, you know, like a real ripped bodybuilder, I guess you could say. But with hair. I couldn't see no ears, but it was big, and it wasn't afraid of me. It had to have known I was there. I don't know why it wouldn't. But it was pretty weird. It was a really weird experience. I don't know. I don't know what it was. I know it was Bigfoot, but when you tell people that around here, yeah, you're crazy. You know, what do you mean? Are you scared of the dark now and stuff like that? But
has there been anything else that happened in that area?
If it has been, nobody will say anything. My family's hunted this same parcel of, I'd say it's probably around, just say 1,000 acres. And that's not all timber. That's crop field too. And if something would happen, they wouldn't say nothing. They just, you know, they just wouldn't believe it. That's kind of people they are.
But you still go out. It didn't shock you that much to where you quit hunting, huh?
No. I mean, believe me, when I go out, after seeing that, it changed my perspective on a lot of things. Before I knew, you know, we was the ultimate predator, but after seeing that, you know, it kind of puts things in perspective, or it did for me. I was like, you know, if this thing wanted to, there was, like I said, I had a 12 gauge with 3.5 inch turkey loads in it. And I think all I'd have done was piss it off.
Yeah. Have you gone back to that area?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I go back, like I said, avid deer hunter. I hunt everything. I even coon hunt at night with dogs. And that takes me back longer than that. I can't remember how many years ago it was, but one time in the same area, my dogs were treeing, and that you couldn't get them dogs off of a tree. And all at once they shut up and they come running back, and they was like growling, looking up this big draw. And I shined my big light up there. I had it, and I couldn't see nothing, but them dogs didn't want nothing to do with it. At that time, you know, I thought, man, what in the heck could that have been, you know? But then after this was years later, I seen this, and then it kind of clicked. I'm like, maybe them dogs seen something, was like, hey, we're out of here, you know?
Yeah, it is interesting, especially with coon dogs. You hear that a lot, you know, and I've never hunted with coon dogs, but the guys I know say once you train them, they won't go off. They'll stay there all night training.
Oh, yeah, and these dogs, I had two walker dogs, and, man, they was hammering tree. I mean, just bark after bark, not missing a beat, and all of a sudden they shut up, and I thought that was strange when I was going to them, and they ran up to me, and they kept looking up the draw, and they kind of growl, and the female would get behind me, and the male was in front of me, but, you know, they kind of growl and snarl. And like I said, I was a lot younger then. I just put the leads on them and back to the truck we went. You know, I didn't want to go investigate at all.
Yeah, your encounter really fascinates me because, you know, I hear a lot of times from hunters, even here in Washington State, they'll say, I saw the strangest bear ever. And I'll ask them, tell me about this bear that you saw. And they're basically describing a Sasquatch. I think in their hearts they know it wasn't a bear, but...
It took me a long time, I mean, for this to actually click and sink in, you know. I didn't even tell my wife, you know. And it's, to this day, you know, it's kind of dumbfounding, you know. I think back, I was like, man, what could I have been asleep? No, I wasn't asleep. I just keep second-guessing myself on that incident, but... On the other one, I mean, the headlights of the truck was on them. I mean,
tell me about that. Was this in the same area?
As the crow flies, it's probably 2 mile, and it's a road that goes through what they call Jinx Hollow. I don't know how it got the name. There's a cave there, an old cave, and I was just driving through there one evening, and it was getting dark, and I was throwing down some sarsaparillas, and it used to be you had to drive down and cross the creek. Now there's bridges across them, but as my truck went down towards the creek, there's kind of a little outcropping rock, and there was one of these things standing on that outcropping, and I was going for my phone. I was going to video this thing, and I was like, proof. I mean, I'm going to tell the people I've told that told me I was crazy, you know, screw you. Look at this. Well, my windows were down, and as I was fumbling for my phone to get things going here, a real loud screech, I don't know if it's a screech or a whistle, kind of in between, scream maybe, and I spun my head out the driver's side of my truck, and there was nothing there, and I spun back around to look where the one was in front of me, and it was gone. Just like a snap, it was gone.
Can you describe what you saw?
Yeah, it was a hairy man. I'll tell you that. But it wasn't a man. It looked like, I guess if I had to explain it, like a chimpanzee standing on two legs that was supersized. I mean, like the size of a gorilla. But bigger than a gorilla, you know what I'm saying? But it was like chimpanzee-ish looking. Now, I got a side view of the face, and it was, I don't know, pale, kind of like a pale yellow, maybe. But the headlights was kind of bright on it, too, so I couldn't say if it was pink, but it looked to me like it was like a yellowish tint.
Yeah, I've heard that, kind of a tan,
Yeah.
How did this one compare to the one that you saw when you were hunting? Was it similar?
This one here wasn't near the mass. It was near the mass, not even close. The big old boy I seen when I was hunting, I don't even think that rock ledge would have held him up. But this one here was standing on. I'm 6 foot, 250 pounds, and it made me look, if I was to stand on it, it'd make me look, you know, small. This in here was more lankier.
Yeah, I would. It's kind of curious that area you're in. I mean, I do get reports from Illinois, but they're pretty hit and miss because a lot of people, they're kind of funny about it in that state. A lot of people don't talk about it. You know what I mean?
Oh, no. And yeah, you ask somebody something and they'll either grin at you or look at you like you're ignorant, you know. And you can't get, you know, any more around here. The permission to get on ground has gotten so tough that a lot of guys, you know, from out of state lease all the land, and, you know, the local guys ain't got a chance to get on it. So there's not a lot of people on this land anymore, you know, except for where I hunt. I still hunt on a handshake.
Yeah, I hear you. What do you think that Sasquatch is? What's your opinion of it, D? And obviously, there's no wrong answer.
Well, I used to think that it was alien, I guess, ET, whatever. But after what I've seen, I don't believe so. I don't know. It's like a lost tribe, if you ask me. I mean, that's what I'd call it, a lost tribe of man, maybe.
Yeah, I'm curious. Why did you think aliens in the beginning?
It just seems, I try to rationalize everything, you know. On Earth, you know, you'd think man would find everything. But, you know, in the universe, it's like the ocean. We have no clue. So, but at the same token, I mean, this thing was upright walking. It didn't look like, you know, if aliens look like they do on TV, it didn't look nothing like that. Unless you're talking of Planet of the Apes, maybe.
Very cool encounter, and I know I mentioned before I like to talk to hunters as much as law enforcement. Speaking of law enforcement, episode 511, It Was No Damn Bear, one of my favorite accounts. I've listened to the show over and over again, and I rarely ever listen to the show anymore. And, you know, Dobbs, you know, it's a deputy sheriff who was helping out the fire watchtower, and he was driving these guys up there. And a fire broke out, and they had an encounter in the middle of the fire. Very cool to hear from law enforcement. Check it out.
I moved about 20 miles away and became a deputy sheriff in a far eastern Tennessee county up in the mountains. Very rural area. Cows outnumber people 5-1 up there. And it's a pretty quiet place. We normally have one or two deputies on at a time. Sometimes only one, sometimes none in the middle of the night. So that gives you an idea of this is a very rural area. And a lot of the county has national forest, or it borders the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. At that time, we had had about 2 or 3 years of drought-like weather. Very dry. We'd had a lot of small fires. We'd had maybe one big fire the summer before. This was more in the fall than in the spring, and we were hoping to get some rain, but it had been a very long, dry, hot summer. So the Forest Service had started a fire watch. Now, nowadays, I think they have more sensors and cameras and things like that. But at the time, they had fire towers, and park rangers and other volunteers would go stay up in these towers for 8 to 12 hours at a time, and they had a reporting protocol, they had radios, they had binoculars, and all of this stuff. So just to help out as a deputy sheriff, what I was doing to save these guys some miles, because the fire tower in our county was, again, 30 to 45 minutes off the beaten path, and these guys would have to drive their vehicle up and just leave them in the woods and walk up. So I discovered that one of these rangers lived near me. His name was Dobbs, and so we struck up a friendship, and I agreed, since I was on duty and it was county gas, that I would pull around, pick him up, and I would drive him up to the foot of the trail, and it was a gravel turnaround area at the end of a forestry service road, and drop him off, and he would walk up the trail for about probably 30 minutes before he got to his fire tower. And then myself or someone else would pick up the off-going ranger, and so we were helping him out. And I struck up a friendship with this guy. He was a good guy. He liked to fish and hunt. And he packed a .44 Magnum revolver on his hip, so we talked about that. And he had put together a little bag, a little kit, and he had coffee and things like that in his kit. And he had a radio, and he had different things, binoculars, and he showed me his kit. He called it his fire watch kit. And he had a big walking stick. And I would drive him up there. And then this particular day, I was actually supposed to pick him up in the afternoon. Someone else had taken him up there. So I had the relief ranger in my car, And I drove up there and dropped him off. And you know, I didn't know this guy. I can't even remember his name right now. But he had just been pulled in from a different district to help out with the fire watch in this area. So he pops out of the car, says, all right, good to meet you. Yeah, good to meet you. And off he goes. He goes on up the trail. And the trail is, again, pretty steep going uphill. So I turned the car around, and I sat there, and I waited. And I had brought a thermos of coffee for the guy and everything. You know, he's my new friend. And I figured about 15 minutes, he ought to be meeting with the other ranger, 5 minutes or so to exchange any pass-ons or anything, and then my friend would come walking out. And he always tried to get out before dark. And at this time of year, dark was coming about 6:30 at night. So I sat there, and you know, I figured about 15 minutes, and I turned on the radio, listened to some news and stuff. And that's when I realized it had been probably about half an hour, so I started to get concerned. It started to get dark. And I turned on spotlight, and I shined it up the trail off my cruiser, thinking, you know, maybe he's delayed. Something's held him up. So I wanted to make sure and illuminate the trail for him. And then it got dark, and so I turned on my overhead lights, the blue and red flashing lights. And I said, well, this way, you know, if he's, you know, all he's got to do is come downhill, but he may wind up on the road, you know, a mile away from me or something. So I wanted to flash the lights to where he could see where I was. And I waited another half hour. Now it's pitch blackout. So I was worried. I was worried about my new friend. I was worried what was going on. So I got out of the car and I grabbed the thermos of coffee. I grabbed my flashlight. And I just at the last second reached back into that car and grabbed my Winchester 44 Magnum rifle. And I had a spare key, so I locked the car up, but I left it running with the lights flashing so that we could find our way back. And I took off up this trail. And I'd never been here before. And it was a lot steeper than I thought. I mean, I was pretty wore out in just about 10 minutes of walking up this thing. And you're basically on your balls of your feet and your toes, and you're reaching for it. And I'm using the butt of this rifle as a walking stick, and I'm grabbing trees to pull myself up. So I kind of had a new respect for these guys. But I get up, you know, well past where I thought the two rangers should have met at the halfway point. And I realized that, you know, it's dark enough. Maybe I should go back. This is when I began to smell smoke. And I realized that, okay, there's a fire. And this is what's delayed these guys. But, like, just what really bothered me at this point was that having been in this situation before, everything that happened in the river came back to me, and I don't know why, except that I was in the woods and it was at night. I'd been in the woods a million times since that incident, but it was like someone took an ice cube and ran right down my back. It just, everything that I had buried in the pit of my stomach came back because my skin began to crawl, and I realized something is not right, and it's not just the fire. Something's not right in the woods, and the thing that's not right is me. I'm out of place. And I distinctly had the feeling that I'd been watched, that something was wrong. And this is why I didn't turn around and go back to my car and call in the fire. And I moved forward at this point, and I started yelling out my buddy's name, you know, Dobbs, Dobbs. And I got concerned for him. And I get all on up the trail, and I got to an area where there was a clearing. Now, at this point, I'm almost up to the fire tower, because I'm almost up to the ridge. I certainly should have seen these guys. And at this point, the smell of smoke is heavy. There's an orange glow in the sky. We had a little moon. The moon had finally come out. And, you know, I didn't just have to use my flashlight to see, but I could see that orange glow in the sky. And I knew we had a forest fire. And as I moved up on the ground in front of me, something caught my eye, and I bent down, and it was Dobbs's hat. It was a ranger hat and had a little pin on the front that, you know, had reflected and I'd seen it. And I got very concerned at this point. And I yelled his name as loud as I could. I just yelled Dobbs as loud as I could and screamed it over and over. And very close to me, I hear a voice that says, shut up, it'll hear you. And that scared the fire out of me because the voice was, you know, 10 feet away from me. And, you know, I turned around and looked, and I took my flashlight, and I'm shining it around, and I finally saw him, and he had his back up against a rock, and due to the steepness of the trail, this rock, he could kind of lean on it and stay on his feet. And there were some scrub cedars, and he was kind of crouched, leaning backwards on this rock, And I just looked at him, and he said, turn that light off. Get over here. It'll hear you. And so I did what he said, and I was walking over to him, and that's when it hit me. But what do you mean it will hear us? What are you talking about? And we got over there, and he just pointed, and he had his gun in his hand. And so, you know, I raised my carbine, and I'm looking around, and he points with his gun, and I look. Now, this is a small oval-shaped clearing. To, you know, from our side of the clearing, we were just inside the woods. To the far side was maybe 35 yards, not a long distance. I had shot that distance with a handgun easily. And, you know, the smell of smoke was heavy in the air, the orange glow from just over the ridge. I knew if you'd walked over top of that ridge, you'd been able to see the fire. And there was just enough moon to where when we looked across that clearing and standing right at the edge of the clearing, we saw it. And it was tall. It you know, dark. It was more backlit than front lit, so I really didn't get a lot of facial features or anything like that, except that I could see that it was tall. Its arms extended pretty low, like down almost to its knees, if not past its knees. And it apparently was moving diagonally, which would be the way the slope would go. But it had seen and heard me. And so it turned at the waist, and it was standing there frozen, just like we were. And Dobbs was pointing his gun in its general direction. I instinctively pointed my gun at it, and this thing stood there and stared at us. And I could see it had very large eyes, like a horse's eyes. And there was just enough light to where I got a little reflection off its eyes. And other than that, I didn't get any impression from it, except there was just no sound in the woods. You'd have thought all kinds of animals had been running and all kinds of stuff. That happened later. Right then, we were just frozen. And it was staring at us. And I knew by the way that the light was that it could see us plainly, and we were staring at it. And this was not a one-second encounter. This was 30, 45 seconds of staring at this thing. And then it just crouched. And it crouched all the way down to the ground, and it's almost like its elbows was on the ground and its arms were extended out. And that's how long its arms were. And it just crouched, but the entire time it never took its eyes off of us. And it when it moved, I saw Dobbs react with his gun, and I thought he was going to shoot him. And the first thing that came to mind was my Uncle Bill scaring the bear, you know. And I just pushed his arm down. Don't shoot it. It's not that I don't think we would have killed it. Just something told me don't shoot it. And we watched it, and it sniffed at the ground, and it used its arms to rake up some grass and sniff. And just as abruptly, it stood up, and it walked backwards into the woods. And by backwards, I'm talking about it took a step, a very deliberate, and then another deliberate step, and then another deliberate step until it was far enough into the woods to where we really couldn't see it. And I'm sorry, bears don't do that. Immediately we heard it moving, and we could hear the trees and the brush, because again, once you're off the trail, this is pretty thickly brushed areas. It's a lot of, you know, thorns and thickets and wait-a-minute vines. And this thing was crashing through that, and it was circling that oval clearance. It didn't take off in another direction. It didn't run downhill away from the fire. It was circling that clearing like it was going to try to come up on us. So I grabbed Dobbs. Dobbs nodded. He snapped out of, you know, stared at this thing. And we started doing the same thing. We started circling in the opposite direction, headed uphill as it circled downhill. This one did not, you know, I kept waiting on it to go, hey, or something, or why, or something, but it never made a noise. And so once we got up closer back to the trail on the top side of the clearing, we took off for the fire tower. You know, this is when I talked to Dobbs. I said, are you okay? He goes, yeah. And I said, what happened? And he, on his way down, when he caught up with the other ranger, they smelled the fire, and they turned around, and they went back up to the tower, and the other ranger began to scout the fire. And Dobbs said, well, I'm going to go down, get with the deputy. We'll call this in, because his radio wasn't working or something. And that's when he ran into this thing. And he said, you know, it was a little more daylight then. But he said as he was walking down, just as he saw it cross the trail, this thing turned and saw him, and they stared at each other on the trail. Now, this is hearsay because I'm telling you what Dobbs told me. And Dobbs just looked at it, and this thing yelled at him, and he turned and ran off the trail. He said the creature just chased him like it was charging him, but stopped about 15 feet away from him and then just yelled. And during this time, Dobbs had dropped his backpack, dropped his walking stick, and he was fumbling for his gun. He said, before I got my gun out, this thing just kind of shook its head, turned around and walked off, but it grabbed his bag and just cocked back and threw it as far as it could as it walked off. And so when that happened, Dobbs headed across the clearing, and when he got to the other side, he saw it again on the north side of the clearing, and that's when he stopped and crouched because he thought, I don't want this thing trailing me through the deep woods. At least in the clearing, I can see it. And he must have been there several minutes until I came across him.
That's an amazing account. Did Dobbs ever tell you any descriptions as far as what he saw? Because he saw it more in the daytime right before the sun was going down.
Well, you know, that night after he gave me the Cliff's Notes, like basically what I told you as we got to the fire tower. But the other ranger had notified other rangers. They'd notified, you know, volunteer fire department, the rural fire department. And we had people coming up the trail. We had animals running. We had, you know, you could see deer bolting across the clearing. Fortunately, the fire was not as, you know, it was not a great fire, but we did get the range. And within a day or so, they had that fire under control. But we, you know, we had 15 or 20 up there within half an hour of this. So the fire took possession of what we were thinking. And once there were plenty of people around, I kind of looked at Dobbs and saluted, you know, and I'll talk to you later, basically. I went back down. I got my cruiser. It was almost out of gas. I had to go down and get gas. So the fire was the news for the next couple of days, and I didn't see Dobbs. A few days later, you know, I got a hold of him because I knew where he lived, and it was raining by this point, you know, which always helps whenever you have, you know, drought situation and fires. So we agreed to meet up for a cup of coffee, and he basically expounded on what, you know, I had just told you. And it's been, you know, 30-some-odd years, but I do remember that he said it was big. It was built like a basketball player is what he said. It was like 7 foot tall, but not chunky, not fat. Bigger in the shoulders than it was at the hips, long-armed, black-furred, and you know, he just described the face as being, you know, just an animal's face, but the thing yelled at him so loud that it, you know, he wasn't sitting there writing down a description. I asked him, you know, I kind of mimicked the sound of it, and he goes, yeah, it's kind of it. So we never really agreed. I never figured out if it was making the same kind of sounds that I'd heard 12, 13 years before. So, you know, I'm not trying to say it was the same animal. I don't know what it was. But, you know, both of us agreed as we sat there one night and had cigarettes and coffee, you know. It was no damn bear. I've hunted all over the United States. I've been to Idaho. I've hunted up in Wyoming. I've hunted in Missouri. I've hunted in Texas. I've seen all kinds of animals, and I continue to hunt and fish all over western North Carolina and eastern Tennessee. It's not a bear. I've seen many bears.
Yeah,
I've seen them.
It doesn't sound like a bear.
I've seen them angry. I've seen them with cubs. I've seen them. I've seen boars. I've seen a lot of animals. This was not a bear.
And finally, we'll hear from Travis from Wisconsin. He was out on his buddy's property, Bill's property, and Bill had an encounter before. Travis never believed him. Travis had a run-in with a female, knocked him over. She was carrying a little one. Very fascinating account. I'd go a little bit longer, but I got complaints last year. My best of shows are too long, so. But Travis has a very fascinating account. Let's take a listen.
A friend of mine, Bill, and myself, we were going to just simply go up to my in-laws' cabin, and they own about 80 acres up there. in central Wisconsin, in Gleason, Wisconsin, to be exact, and just do some scouting for preseason bow hunting and gun season. And we were going to meet up on the weekend. I was going to get there Friday, and he was going to be there Saturday, but he showed up for Friday anyways. But I got there about noon. He showed up about 3 o'clock. And, excuse me, we sat around, talked some BS, you know, and drank a couple beers. And then we went into town, and which wasn't that far. I had some dinner at the local tavern, just a burger and fries type stuff. And came back. Nothing happened or anything like that. It was just kind of boring, actually. And sacked out at probably about 10 o'clock, I think. And the next day, we got up, and he likes to use a, what's it called now? One of those old rifles. I can't think what it's called. But anyways, so I grabbed my rifle and out to the woods I went first. And I went to our cabin faces the south. And there's an opening of about 40 to 50 yards opening where there is no trees. It's just corn. And it goes off to the left about 150 acres. Or, I mean, 150 yards, I mean. And then it turns to the left, and it goes all the way to the road, which is about another 125, 150 yards again. Well, I guess at the front door to the cabin faces the south. If I went off and I went to the right, which is about 25 to 35 yards from the cabin to the wood line. And I went that way because I know there was a deer trail over there that I wanted to follow. So I went that way and I followed it. And it was probably about 35 feet into the tree line as I followed it and then got to the end where it turned left. And when I turned left, I kept going and following the deer sign and seeing if there was any kind of movement or anything like that. And I had my dog Nova with me. And we're just running around, and she's running around ruffling up leaves and grabbing wood ticks and stuff like that. And didn't really see a couple of squirrels and rabbits, things like that, nothing particular. And then Bill, he went out wherever he was, and we ended up meeting at the end of the day, approximately about 5 o'clock. After that, we just we sat around, and we had some more beers, we decided to cook some burgers and hot dogs out on the grill next to our campfire. And all of a sudden, Nova, the hair on her back kind of stood up, you know, and she started barking off to the west towards the tree line where I had entered that day earlier. And that was not like her. There was something was disturbing her. So I had, for cautious sake, I just picked up the chain and I hooked her onto the chain because I didn't want to run off. Because she didn't usually run off anyways. She was not, she's not that kind of dog. But something wasn't right with me. And obviously there was something not right with Nova. And I didn't want anything to happen, and I just couldn't place my finger on what was wrong. But she just kept barking. She intended to go there. She had the chain completely tightened. There was something there she wanted, and it wasn't a squirrel or a rabbit. I could tell that it was something. And we ate our dinner and everything, and we let her bark her way to madness. And eventually we went into the cabin and called it a night. But something disturbed me even as I lay down in our separate bunks that night. I just couldn't place my fingertips on it. There was something wrong. I could feel it within and myself, I just didn't know what it was. And Nova was still uneasy, and even in the cabin with us. We fell asleep eventually, and then approximately, I'm assuming it was around 3 o'clock, I think it was, we both got awakened by a very large scream, a roar almost, to the point where it kind of like, you know, you ever hear a lion roar?
Yeah.
Where it shakes even the inside of your body. It was like that. It was that loud. It was like right outside the door. I personally was waiting for something to come flying through the window. But it only happened twice. And Nova, instead of trying to bark and her hair going up and anything like she was earlier, this time she was doing just the opposite. She was hiding under the bed. It only happened twice. It scared the living bejesus out of me. I grabbed my rifle. I didn't know what it was. I just knew if there was something coming through the door, I didn't know what it was, but it was going to get shot. I knew that. And we didn't hear nothing come up. I didn't hear anything walking around the cabin, and I didn't hear anything walk away. But there was something out there, and it woke us up, and it left. And the next day, we didn't really talk about it because I didn't want to bring it too much up to Bill, because Bill's kind of touchy about certain things, and he freaks out easy. We'll just say it that way.
Yeah,
he freaks out easy. And that morning, we ate our breakfast, and then it was probably about 10, 11 o'clock, we decided to go out to the woods again. But this time, I still didn't feel right. There was something happened last night, something happened in the morning, and now we're going to go out. So I left Nova home, or at the cabin, I should say. I hooked her back up outside and left her at that. Went the same exact route. Went to the right, got to the deer trail, looking for any fresh tracks or any droppings, anything like that. And this time I was taking my time. I was more seriously looking for deer tracks and any kind of signs that they were there than I was the first day. As I got down to the corner, I started hearing gunshots. And the gunshots were coming from the east. I was facing south, and I was about to turn that left on that corner by on the edge of the field. And that's when I started hearing the gunshots, when I got right about there. And I walked approximately 50 feet to 60 feet. I was about 30 to 35 feet into the wood line. And I was approximately directly across from the front door of the cabin. And I looked, and I can see Bill was coming out of the cabin. And he had his rifle, and he had his binoculars, and he was getting ready to come out. And when I got about that area is when I started hearing screams, and I can honestly say they were screams of like agony. They were very loud screams, like like I've heard on your program how people describe them as screams like a woman screaming. They were like that, but they were really, really loud and almost thunderous, I guess you would say, because they were so deep. It was a real deep, thunderous sound, but it was the firing of the guns that were going off. It was both shotguns and rifles. I could tell that because, you know, the on a shotgun it rolls. The sound of a shotgun rolls when you shoot it.
Yeah.
And a rifle doesn't, you know. And so as I was curious, I started walking towards the east even more so. And then this is when it the strangest thing happened is I started hearing branches breaking, twigs snapping, leaves being ruffled up. I mean, like a bull was coming through the woods. And before I could even look to see what was being, and was coming from behind me, and before I could even see what was happening, all I knew was I was being knocked down to the ground. I mean, it took me at least 2 feet off the ground and flew me at least 3 feet. I landed hurting my elbow and my shoulder. And to this very day, I still got to have MRIs done on my shoulder. And that this incident happened in 95 or in 2015. And but I got up, and when I got up, all I seen was the two creatures. One was approximately, Bill and I figured it out. It was approximately around 7.5 feet, give or take, you know, who knows for exact height. But there was another one, and the first one was black. The tall one was black, completely black, except for on its right shoulder blade. It was like almost what you would say, like a white spot, but not complete. It wasn't white. It was more of a grayish white spot on her bottom of her right shoulder blade. And then in her right hand, she was holding and pulling along another little creature. And this little poor little thing could just barely keep up with her as she's running through the woods. You know, this one is like making a step, going up in the air, making a step, going up in the air. And I mean, kind of like a little girl would be running with her rag doll, you know, and that's what the creature was doing. But the little one wasn't black. The little one was, what's the color? Red, like a reddish hair. But I never got to see either one of their faces. They were running to the east. What I did notice, though, is the black one is the one that really is took my focus for some reason. Oh, my God. I think about this. It's something else. I remember looking at her and close my eyes here. I remember looking at her and watching her run with this little baby one. And all you seen was like the muscle tone and the massness. The mass of this thing was just huge. It had to go 4 to maybe close to 4.5 feet wide, you know, and it was just huge. And it didn't take long. I probably had like, 20 seconds of watching it run through the woods, because our woods there it's not really thick, because my father-in-law has been selling a lot of the wood to the local lumber company so it could pay for the taxes on the property. And so I got to see her for quite some time, as far as about 20 seconds anyways. And then I spotted her, because I came out of the wood line, and after that, Bill had gotten on the ATV. I didn't realize he had been watching it through the binoculars. He got on the ATV, and he came swinging over by me real quick. And then we went to the far end of the property line, because that's where we had seen, I had seen first, as far as I know. She came out of the corner of the property line and then jumped over the property line into the next property, where that sound was coming from, where the gunfire was coming from. And the gunfire had ceased by now. And that was the last we seen her. And we went to the property line. We seen where she crossed. the grass was all mowed over and stuff. And when she crossed, she just literally, I wouldn't even say stepped over. It was like watching a runner jump a hurdle. And she just grabbed that little one, and she just pulled it right along with it. Like it was nothing. And that I just felt so sorry for that little one when I think about it. I never did see her face. All I seen was the back of her, and it was humongous. It was just all muscle tone. And the little one was just like a little rag doll.
What did Bill say when he came up? Your buddy.
Oh, he told me the night before too that he was he felt nervous. He thought there was something wrong with Noah, but he didn't tell me that, and I didn't mention it to him because at the same time I didn't want him to freak out. But what got me is he turned around at the corner down there. He says, I told you, that was the effing Bigfoot.
And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out sasquatchchronicles.com. You can become a member and get additional shows. I'll be back on Friday for the members. For everyone else, I will see you guys next week. Happy holidays, everyone.